present in the present. And the one who has given up worrying is called a sannyasi, whatever be the robe that he is wearing. More in the next class. Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. Om Sadashiva Samarambham Shankaracharya Madhyamam Asmadacharya Paryantam Vande Guru Paramparam. Om. I had pointed out in the last class that in the 6th chapter of the Gita, Bhagavan deals with 5 important topics with regard to dhyanam or meditation. And those 5 topics are bahiranga sadhanam or general disciplines to be observed throughout one's transaction so that one can practice meditation successfully. This is bahiranga sadhanam. Then he deals with antaranga sadhanam or specific disciplines to be observed just before the starting of meditation. Then the 3rd topic is dhyana swarupam, the actual process of meditation. And then the 4th topic is dhyana phalam, the benefit of meditation. And finally, the 5th topic is dhyana pratibandha pariharav, obstacles to meditation and their remedies. Of these 5 topics, Krishna begins the chapter with the 1st topic, namely bahiranga sadhanani, the general disciplines a meditator should observe. And I also talked about the significance of the general discipline. The significance is this: if we do not have a discipline during our transactions, then the mind can go through violent emotional disturbances. And when the mind is disturbed during the transaction, the disturbance forms a deep impression or samskara in the mind. It creates a scar. And once a deep disturbance samskara is formed in the mind, that samskara will come out whenever the mind is quiet. You can study your mind regularly itself. When your mind is not preoccupied, whatever is deep in your subconscious, that alone comes out. They are like bubbles under the water. Or you can imagine a rubber ball or a piece of wood. When you keep it under the water, it will remain so. When the hand is removed, that wood will surface up. Similarly, in our subconscious mind also, there are so many emotions, they are all waiting. Now they do not surface because our mind is preoccupied with something. And as long as the conscious mind is involved in deliberate action, the subconscious mind will remain underneath. The moment the conscious mind takes some rest, some relaxation, the subconscious mind is waiting just to bubble up. And when you try to practice meditation, that is the ideal time, your conscious mind withdraws from preoccupation, then the subconscious impressions are bound to come. And if during the day I had disturbing emotions, they will remain as samskaras, and during meditation, those transactions alone will come. And therefore, we should find out a method by which violent disturbances are not entertained. And I don't allow my subconscious mind to form disturbing samskara. And how to do that? How to neutralize the possible scar in the mind? That is by training the mind to have samatvam. So as they give the example of the great philosopher, when he heard the news that he has lost all his wealth which was coming in the ship itself sank. And the news came to the philosopher, businessman, and they said, "You have lost everything." Then the first response was, "What?" Almost the heart was about to stop. He is a philosopher, he has trained his mind to respond to the situation properly. Immediately he recovered, got his balance back and made the second statement, "So what?" This changing from "what" to "so what" requires tremendous mental training, and that is samatvam. And this samatvam or tranquility is called karma yoga. And therefore Krishna talks about karma yoga as a method of maintaining the tranquility of mind. The graph of our mind doesn't go too high also, it doesn't go too low also. It is almost a balanced graph. And to emphasize the role of karma yoga, Krishna wants to glorify the karma yogi. And the karma yogi is none other than a grihastha, a householder. And therefore, Krishna praises a householder. Therefore, sixth chapter begins with glorification of a householder. What type of householder? Karma yogi householder. And by way of glorifying a householder, indirectly Krishna is glorifying karma yoga. And by way of glorifying karma yoga, Krishna is glorifying samatvam. So you should have the global vision. Grihastha glorification is equal to karma yoga glorification. Karma yoga glorification is equal to samatvam glorification. And how does Krishna glorify a householder? By pointing out that a householder alone is a real sannyasi. He gives a title, sannyasi pattangudututar. So that means you are all real sannyasi. And not only that, appadi solli vittirunda thevaliye. He says the regular sannyasis are not real sannyasis. Solli namma thalaiyila oru kuttu poduttar. So therefore, the conventional sannyasi is not a real sannyasi. A householder alone is a real sannyasi. Then again Krishna points out, a conventional meditator is not a real meditator. Who is a conventional meditator? The one who has withdrawn from all the activities and he is sitting in a quiet place by taking to proper posture, closing the eyes, keeping the body straight. He is the regular conventional meditator. Krishna says, that conventional meditator is not true meditator. Then who is true meditator? The karma yogi grihastha is a true meditator. So Krishna here goes to the extent of criticizing a sannyasi for the sake of glorifying a grihastha. So naturally, Shankaracharya is a little bit worried while writing a commentary, because Shankaracharya is a champion of sannyasa. Tarangadakya sannyasana beshwarava. So it is very interesting when he writes commentary on the Gita, Manushyaha, word undirukum. Shankaracharya will write, is equal to sannyasi. Avarku manushyan sonnale sannyasi da. Such a vehement, intense champion of sannyasa is naturally disturbed when Krishna criticizes a sannyasi, and therefore Shankaracharya adds a footnote. He says, don't take this criticism seriously. Krishna doesn't want to really criticize a sannyasi. The purpose is, he wants to glorify a grihastha. Therefore, temporarily, he is giving a seeming criticism. This in Shastra is called Nahi Nindanyayaha. This is the methodology used in scriptures. What is the methodology? Criticism of something for the purpose of glorifying something else. Criticism of something for the sake of glorifying something else. There, the focus is not on criticism, but the focus is on glorification. And this is called what? Nahi Ninda Nyayaha. Applying this law, Shankaracharya says, Krishna is not really criticizing sannyasi. Krishna wants to highlight karma yoga. Having glorified a grihastha karma yogi in the first verse, in the second verse, Krishna is justifying that glorification. Why does he call a grihastha as a real sannyasi? There must be some reason behind it. Normally seeing, a grihastha cannot be called a sannyasi because he has not renounced anything. He is very much at home. He has got all the possessions intact, all the bank balance, shares, landed property, all those things he has. And he has got a big kutumba also. He introduces, this is my parent, this is my peti, this is my daughter-in-law, this is my son-in-law. So when a grihastha is possessing everything, how can Krishna say grihastha is a sannyasi? Because the word sannyasi means a renouncer. Therefore, the question comes, what entitles a grihastha to enjoy the name of a sannyasi? And Krishna gives the reason here. Krishna says, sannyasi means a renouncer. That is the literal meaning. The word sannyasi does not say renouncer of what? It didn't say that renouncer of wife and children. It doesn't say renouncer of home and job. Sannyasi means renouncer. Therefore, Krishna argues, a karma yogi grihastha is a renouncer because he has renounced his concern for the future. That is the main criterion to become a karma yogi. Because one of the biggest problem or obstacle a person faces in life is concern about future. What will happen to me after retirement? 35 vayasa irukku. Ini engayo kadakara. Will my children take care of me? Will they do shraddham after my death? So thus the human mind is capable of worrying. The one who drops the worry, here the worry is called sankalpaha. Constantly being obsessed with the future to such an extent that he is not efficient in the present. And I was telling in the last class, we have to make a difference between worrying and planning. We don't say we should not plan. What is the difference between plan and worry? I told you, plan is a deliberate action which you can do at a stipulated time. What are your plans for year 2000? Okay, vandirukko illaya enna ellam pannam diary la ella ezhudhi vechi nadakka poradho illayo, at least you can write down. Then what are you going to do in the business field, in the family field, in the health field, in the financial field? You do it deliberately at a stipulated time, whereas worry is not a deliberate action, but it is a reaction or obsession which happens in spite of me. Planning makes me efficient in the present, whereas worrying makes me inefficient in the present. A karma yogi is not against planning, he is against worrying. And therefore, Krishna says, every karma yogi grihastha, he might have planned, but he doesn't worry. Therefore, he is called what? Sankalpa sannyasi. The one who gives up worrying. And since he has renounced worry, he can be called a renouncer. That is what is said in the second sloka, which I introduced in the last class. Yam sannyasam iti prahuh tam yogam viddhi pandava. He Arjuna, by the word sannyasa or renunciation, I don't mean the conventional renunciation. I don't mean the chaturthashrama praptihi. Because Krishna doesn't want to recommend conventional sannyasa in the Gita. In fact, Gita is a grihastha book. The teacher is a grihastha. Who is the teacher? Krishna. Krishna is grihastha or sannyasi? Sandeham irukko? Not ordinary grihastha. 16,008 wives means what? Mahagrihastha. And who is the student? Arjuna. Avarum Krishna paakarapodu, he is also equally great. Wherever he goes, marries one. Therefore, Arjuna is also Mahagrihastha. And who has compiled the teaching? Vyasacharya is also Grihastha. Therefore, remember, throughout the Gita, Krishna doesn't want to recommend conventional sannyasa. And therefore, he says, sannyasa is nothing but karma yogam viddhi. If you are a good karma yogi, you will get all the benefits of a sannyasi. In fact, that is advantageous. You will get the benefit of grihasthashrama also. And you will get the benefit of sannyasa also. And asanyasta sankalpaha yogi nabhavati. If a person has to become karma yogi, he has to necessarily renounce sankalpa. Sankalpa means what? I told you, obsession with future. And how do you define obsession with future? Obsession to such an extent that you are not able to function in the present. Solrama illayo kai kaalu odradilla swamiji ore variya irundhathu kai kaalu odradilla engrom. That is what we mean by worry. So a person who gives up sankalpa alone is a karma yogi. And therefore, karma yogi can be called what? Sankalpa sannyasi. Continuing. Aru rukshor muner yogam. Karma karana muchyate. Yoga rudhasya tasyaiva.